I know it's hard to tell sometimes if a video review is unbiased.
How about this guy, right? I've recorded this intro a few different ways and I'm not happy with any of them, mainly because there's a lot of talk at the moment about fake reviews and bots spamming review videos, filling them with good or bad comments to try to sway what people think. I was up last night thinking, how can I make this different? And I can't. There's going to be people that say I'm biased no matter what. So here's the facts, right? I didn't get paid for this video. I did get the printer sent to me by FLSun for free, but I didn't agree to any kind of favourable review. In fact, I specified one condition before they sent it, and that was if there was anything bad, I was going to show it. So at the risk of spoiling the video and getting people to switch to something else, there were no issues. There were a few quirks with this printer that I found. All I can do is show you my experience. I've printed for about 100 hours now on this printer. I'll follow up in a few weeks with a few hundred more hours. And I consciously had in my mind where I might be biased. So hopefully I'll show you an independent view. Here's what I've been doing for the last couple of weeks. I was expecting something big and this package didn't disappoint. There's a few layers of parts that are really well packed, as you'd expect from a modern printer, so nothing surprising there. Everything's clearly labeled, there's paper instruction manual, albeit somewhat smaller than I expected. There's a box with a glue stick that I'll never use. All the haters, I'll see you in the comments below. How much you love using glue sticks. All the Allen keys you'll need, an extra nozzle, some lube, a needle for unblocking, a pressure fitting, and a USB, which might come in handy. I won't go through every step because the instructions were pretty good. I normally treat the instructions more like a suggestion, but not knowing Delta Print as well, I thought there might be an order of operations to get this together, and there was. The most important part is the effector. The screw placement wasn't perfect on the instructions, but it's easy enough to work out. There's a fairly standard setup with a grub screw holding the orientation of the pin in the arm joint. The arms are a little tricky to get apart and into place while you're trying to screw in the screws. When putting the assembly together, the thought of this being a flimsy spider went right out the window. The unit felt pretty strong, and manually moving the arms, you could feel the resistance you want to feel when you're moving around a XY gantry, so I was gaining confidence in this printer. There's a good sized touchscreen and a camera, although the fixed position of the camera wasn't great and missed the top of anything taller than about 100mm. One of the files on the printer was a new camera mount that I'll probably be taking a look at some point. They say the assembly should take about an hour, but with me trying to juggle three cameras and get some decent footage, I managed to stretch that out to about an hour and a quarter, so it's definitely doable. If you put together a Lego set, you can totally assemble this printer, except you won't end up with a spaceship or a dragon at the end. One thing that might come in handy that I found 2 days after I put it together, that USB drive that was in the kit, it's got a video on there that you can follow, including the one part of the paper instructions that I found a little bit unclear. So if you're like me and tend to ignore instructions at first, that little tip might save you from some unnecessary confusion. FLSun has their own slicer, which is just a fork of Orca slicer under the hood, so it should be familiar to a lot of people. I wanted to do the initial print tests as a newbie and not do anything too advanced. No tricky customizations, just using the profiles that are included with the slicer and everything out of the box. In a future video, we'll push the limits and we'll see what we can do with this printer, so stay tuned for that. Vibration calibration is the first thing to do once things are assembled, and it makes sense. It's supposed to go real fast. So you want it to vibrate to the point where the print is going to be affected, so that the printer knows how to compensate for it. Then bed leveling. And when you think it's done, it'll go back down for another pass around the extremes, but then it's really down to business. One feature, if you're printing from the touchscreen, is that you can tick the vibration check and bed leveling before any print you're about to start. As well, you can do a time lapse with the built-in camera. What I like about Core XY printers is that the bed goes up and down only at every Z change, so it's quite stable. Some have a little bit of flex in the cantilevered bed, but the bed on the Delta printer is even more stable. been completely static. In this case, it is rock solid. There's a Benchy stored on the printer, and I think I've printed one in the last 6 years, so why not? Watching it print, at first it was a little unnerving about how fast this actually went. In 8 minutes, it was done. And pretty good, except for a little bit of warping on the front, but that was probably more likely the bad filament I was using. I don't know why I started with that. I tried again with some high-speed filament, and the result you can see was much better. For the speed, it's near perfect with some tiny stringing hairs, so that's something to keep in mind. If you want to go fast, high-speed filament is the way to go. With the controversy around Benchies at the moment, I thought I'd try the Bodhi that's trending on printables as a replacement, and it sliced and worked really well. 29 minutes for the high-speed filament version. The quality is pretty good. The longer bridges definitely have some droop to it, and in this case, I didn't see any noticeable difference between the high-speed filament and the regular PLA. With the standard benchmark done, let's get printing. Of course, I did do a few more calibration prints to see how accurate it is out of the box. I much prefer tests that are actually usable after testing and not a throwaway. So let everyone know in the comments what you use for a benchmark print that's useful after it's printed. Now, this printer is super fast. I fitted out a drawer with Gridfinity in an afternoon, a pretty large functional dice tower in about 2 hours. There's a kind of magic you see in that suit making machine from Spider-Man. The build volume is 260 millimeters round and 330 millimeters high. However, the top is a little conical like a circus tent because of the way that the arms move. A more real world usable height is around 285 millimeters. This is one of the reasons why I hadn't entertained the idea of a Delta printer, because printing a square would mean it has to fit in the circle. In this printer's case, that means a max of about 183 millimeters for a perfect square each side. When I was thinking about this, I looked at everything I've printed in the past, and the largest printed square would fit on this bed easily, so maybe it's not as big a deal as I thought it was in my head. The hot end can go as high as 330 degrees and the bed 110, but with no chamber heating, it relies on the enclosure to keep heat in for printing material like PETG and ASA. The enclosure does a good job with this. I set the hot end to 200 and the bed to 90. The chamber got to about 32 degrees in 5 minutes, and it stays pretty consistent, which is what you want. So far, there's only two issues that I've come across. If you have a very full 1 kilo roll of filament and mount it inside the printer, if you print something very small, when the effector retracts back up, the filament can get a little loose and skip the side of the roll on your next print when it goes back down, which means it can get tangled. Now, this happened twice out of 60 or 70 prints. But you have the option of placing the filament in a holder above the printer and feeding it through an inlet there. The other issue I had was the clips that hold the air hose to the wires were slipping down to where the action was. This wore through the tape pretty quickly, but it would take a lot more to wear through the actual wires. I got around that by not feeding the filament through the clips, which must have been pulling that clip down to the effector. It doesn't affect the way the filament moves when it retracts back up, so it's a fairly simple workaround. I put some tape around the air hose just under the top clip and made sure it was down a little bit lower than I had it originally, which actually helped with that. The other problem of the filament skipping off the full roll when it was retracted after a small print. And when I contacted FLSun about those issues, they were very quick to respond, but being a review unit, I can't really say that I can be objective about the support that they provide. If you've seen or read anything about the T1, the original was known to be super loud. Now, FSun has done a lot of work, and I was expecting it to be much louder than it actually was. The important test is when printing. The decibel count averaged about 50 to 60 most of the time. When doing a more intense print, it hit about 65 decibels, pretty much the same as an average conversation. Open the door though, and it's more like you're standing on a busy street. So we're talking about 80 decibels, but let's be honest, no one's printing with the door wide open. Will I leave it in my study and work next to it? I'm probably not the best test subject here. My study is pretty small and I have this weird thing where my eyes start to get irritated if I sit in a room with a printer running for too long. But having said that, I've actually been in the room with this printing most days for the last couple of weeks and I've not had the same problem. I'm guessing the enclosure works well to keep the VOCs down, but so far I've only been using different versions of PLA. I will be starting to print with PETG and nylon in the next few weeks, and I'm guessing I'll be moving it out because I don't want to sit next to a heap of melting toxic filament, not because of the noise. I haven't even discussed the price yet, but it's another win for the T1 Pro. Right now it's $599 US, which is incredible value for the features you get. And it's unfortunate I didn't pay for this printer because the cynical of you out there I'm sure will say I'm biased, but I'm seriously impressed with this printer, mainly the speed. But as a test, in the past when I print something cool, I normally rush and show my family and they typically humor me and say it's great and act impressed. The classic, love you, but what is this weird thing you've made and why? But the things I've been printing with the T1 have genuinely impressed my family. My wife holding the self-watering pot plant actually said it felt like one of the nicest things that I've printed. So that's the first impression of the new T1 Pro from FLSun. The usual trending videos that I do will be on this from now on, at least for the foreseeable future. If you wanna make sure you don't miss them, subscribe. Let me know if there's something you want to see tested on here and I'll bring you a video about it. But for now, that's it. Thanks, viewers. I'll see you next time.